Evet, kayıta da başlayalım. Bak, kayıta başlayalım. Şimdi arkadaşlar, size ilk önce dediğim gibi Excel ya da herhangi bir uygulamada uniform 0-1 sayı üretme metodu nedir? Algoritması nedir? Bundan bahsedeceğim. Burada nasıl bir yöntem kullanıyorlar? Uniform 0-1 sayı üretmek her şeyin temeli. İlk aşama uniform 0-1-1 rastsal sayı üretmek. İkinci aşamada ise, ikinci slaytlarda ise uniform 0-1'den diğer rastsal sayılar nasıl üretilir onu göreceğiz. Yani bu iki aşamalı. Fakat öncesinde şöyle küçücük bir yer kalmıştı istatistik review'unda. Burayı hızlıca geçeceğim. Yani bu Poisson süreci kalmıştı. Poisson proses bu son örnekti. İstatistiksel review kısmında sadece şurası kalmıştı hatırlarsanız az bir kısım. Burayı gördükten sonra yeni konuya geçeceğim. Evet, şimdi bu kaldığımız yeri Türkçe yapacağım. Yeni konu İngilizce başlayacağım. Şimdi rastsal sayılar nerede kullanılır simülasyonda? İşte rastsal değişkenler talepler arasındaki süreyi modellemede, talepleri modellemede kullanılır. Yani biz geçen ders hatırlarsanız rastsal süreçleri modelleri görmüştük. İşte kesikli modeller, sürekli modeller. Bunlar değişik alanlarda kullanılıyor simülasyonlarda. Envanteri ve supply chain'lerde olsun ya da kuyruk modellerinde olsun. Bu tür şeyleri yani kuyruk modellerinde, envanter modellerinde, güvenirlik modellerinde rastsallık vardır. Kuyrukta nerede vardır örneğin? Kuyruk modellerinde müşterilerin gelişinde, servis sürelerinde rastsallık gözlemleriz. İnventörde nerede rastsallık vardır? Taleplerde, envanterde sizin tuttuğunuz ürün olan taleplerde. Güvenirlikte nerede rastsallık vardır? Ürünün yaşam süresinde gibi yerlerde değişik modeller kullanılır. Ve bir de şu durum var arkadaşlar. Datanız yeterince data yoksa elinizde, veri yoksa ne yapabiliriz? Tamam mı? Limited data dediği bir şeyi modellemek istiyorsunuz. Müşterilerin varış zamanını ya da gelişlerini ama geçmişe dair hiçbir veri ya da çok az veri var elinizde. Bu durumda ne yapılabilir gibi dört tane seçenek var burada. Şimdi kuyruk sistemlerinde müşterilerin gelişi genelde exponential kullanılır. Üstel yani müşteriler arasında geçen süre için en uygun genelde exponential'dır. Normalde kullanabilirsiniz. Normal servis süresi için. Servis süresinde hafif değişkenlik varsa normal dağılım servis süresi için uygundur. Envanter modellerine bakalım bir de. Envanter modellerinde talebin en güzel talebi nasıl modelleriz? Poisson'la. Poisson hatırlayın. Kesikli bir dağılımdı. 3, 5, 7 gibi kesikli değerler alıyordu. Poisson bu yüzden uygun. Lead time için gamma uygun. Lead time hani bir sipariş verdiniz, o gelene kadar geçen süre. Gene süreden bahsediyoruz. Sürekli bir değişken. Dolayısıyla gamma dağılımı uygun olur. Yani burada ben hangi dağılım nerede uygun onları göstermeye çalışıyorum. Güvenirlikte ise güvenirlik ve maintainability ise üstel gene bozulmaya yani makine mesela başlattınız. Bozulmasına kadar geçen sürede üstel en uygun dağılım. Ya da viable, üstelin daha gelişmiş hali gamma da gene time to failure yani bozulmaya kadar geçen süreyi modellemede güzel kullanılabilecek modeller. Kullanılabilecek rastsal değişkenler. Şimdi limited information da arkadaşlar limited information demek sizin elinizde yeterince veri yok. Şimdi göreceğiz biz ileride. Veri çok önemli simülasyonda. Veri sayesinde biz modellere karar veriyoruz. Yani müşterilerin gelişi üstel mi gamma mı veri sayesinde oluyor hepsi. Ama sınırlı bilginiz varsa kullanabileceğiniz 3 dağılım şu. Yani şurada yazmayı açalım. Şunlar uygun dağılımlar. Neden bunlar uygun sizce? Evet, birincisi uniform dağılım arkadaşlar. Tamamen bakın size biri diyor ki müşterilerin geliş süresi nasıl dağılır diyorsunuz. Siz de bir eksperte soruyorsunuz. Ekspert hiçbir data yok. Uzman size diyor ki ya 3 ile 8 arasında servis yani bu makina şu parçayı işliyor. 3 dakikayla 8 dakika arasında sürüyor ama çok da emin değilim yani. Minimum 3 dakika maksimum 8 dakika alıyor diyor. Başka da bir bilgi vermiyor. Bu durumda sizin en uygun dağılım uniform. Bakın bu dağılım yoğunluk fonksiyonu. Burada da x'in alacağı değerler. 3 ile 8 dakika arasında bir süre sürüyor makinenin bu parçayı işlemesi ama başka da hiçbir bilginiz yok. Uniform gördüğünüz gibi her değere eşit olasılık, eşit yoğunluk veriyor. uniformly dağılması bu demek. Yani sizin için ortada olması, 8 olması da, yani 8'e yakın olması da mümkün. 3'e küçük olması da mümkün. Tamam. Bu tamamen hiçbir şey bilmediğinizi gösteriyor uniform. Yani bir dağılım hakkında sıfır bilginiz var neredeyse. Sadece minimum ve maksimum değerini biliyorsunuz. Başka bir uzman geliyor diyor ki ya 3 ile 8 arasında ama en çok aldığı değer de 5. Ben biliyorum 3 ile 8 arasında ama en çok ihtimalle 5 dakika sürüyor diyor. O zaman sizin kullanacağınız dağılım neydi bu arkadaşlar, bu dağılım biliyor musunuz? Bu nasıl bir dağılım? 3 ile 8 arasında ama most likely değeri 5. Bu dağılımın adı ne arkadaşlar? Bunu bilen, hatırlayan var mı? Şu uniform. Bu neydi? Evet.
Hocam hiç görmedik ama şeklinden triangular herhalde.
Evet, triangular arkadaşlar. Bu dağılım triangular, üçgensel dağılım triangular. Aslında geçen ders biraz görmüştük. Dur bakalım, göstermemiş miydik geçen ders? Tabii hızlı geçmiştik biraz. Bunlar şey diye. Ha, bakın burada görmüşüz geçen derste. Triangular. Bu sıfırdan başlamış. Minimum value, most likely, mod ve maximum value. Minimum, most likely ve maximum. Triangular da çok kullanılan bir dağılım şeyde, modellemede. Çünkü neden? Bu 3 tane bilgi, expert'in size 3 bilgi vermesi yeterli. Minimum alabileceği değer, en fazla ve en olası değeri. Triangular'da çok yaygın kullanılıyor. Aynı şekilde beta'da, modellemede eğer fazla bilginiz yoksa, sadece expert opinion'ınız varsa kullanılan modeller. Evet, şimdi şu tahtayı silelim. Annotate, clear all. Tamam, şimdi tahtayı sildik. Mouse'u alalım elimize. Evet. Python process'le şimdi Python process var bir de arkadaşlar. Python'un dağılımını görmüştük değil mi? Python dağılımını geçen ders. Python'u görmüştük. T anına kadar, yani belli bir sürede olan olayları gösteriyordu. Python'a gitmeye çalışıyorum. Python en son görmüştük galiba. Kesikten. Python distribution neydi? E üzeri eksi lambda. Lambda üzeri x bölü x faktöriyel. Bu neydi? Probability of, yani x tane olayın olma olasılığı belli bir aralıkta. E üzeri eksi lambda. Lambda üzeri x. Ve x faktöriyel. Tamam, bu olasılık Poisson olasılığı. Yani bir yerde saat 12 ile 1 arasında 10 tane kamyon geçiyor normalde. Her gün gözlemliyorsunuz. Normalde 10 kamyon geçiyor ortalama. Buradan herhangi başka bir gün baktığınızda 8 kamyon geçme olasılığı nedir? 3 kamyon ya da hiç kamyon geçmeme olasılığı. Olay occurrences, yani olay sayısı olasılığı bu şekilde hesaplanıyor. Burada lambda ortalama olay sayısı. Yani lambda benim verdiğim örnekte 10. Lambda 10 dedik mesela. Ortalama 10 kamyon geçiyor. Tamam mı? 10 kamyon geçiyor. Ama siz farklı bir sayıda kamyon geçmesinin olasılığını bulmak için Poisson'u kullanabiliyorsunuz. Evet. Ya da mesela x'e 0 koyarsak ne demek oluyor? Burada hiç kamyon geçmemesi 12 ile 1 arasında. Tamam, bu Poisson process. Poisson distribution. Poisson distribution bu şekilde. Proseste ne fark ediyor? Proses deyince time işin içine giriyor. Şuradaki proses, Poisson process dediğimizde time işin içine giriyor. Ve bakın burada nt, şimdi sadece 12 ile 1 arası değil de t anına kadar olan olay sayısının n tane olması gibi olasılıkları hesaplıyorsunuz. Mesela benim yazdığım formülde t yok gördüğünüz gibi. Lambda çarpı. Bu çünkü birim zaman. Bu birim zaman için. Sadece unit zaman için. Şimdi bunu t ile genişletirseniz lambda t t zaman aralığını, yani Poisson şu formülü elde ediyoruz. Şuradakini. Tamam mı? T anına kadar normalde lambda t tane olay oluyorsa burada n tane olay olma olasılığı nedir? Bu Poisson süreci olarak geçiyor. Formülde bu şekilde hesaplanıyor. Evet, Poisson process'te arkadaşlar şu nara birincinin geliş süresi, ikinci olayın geliş süresi, mesela olay olmasından bahsediyoruz ya t anına kadar. Burada işte Biz bu prosesi bayağı çalışmıştık. Rastsal alanlar hatırlıyor mu arkadaşlar? 321 alanlar. 321 alanlar hatırlıyorsa burada çok soru sormuştuk da. Fason süreçleriyle alakalı. İşte T ana kadar olay olmama olasılığı ya da T ana kadar 3 olay olma olasılığı, bunlar Fason süreciydi. Bu da çok kullanılan dağılımlardan bir tanesi. Şimdi simülasyonda çok kullanılan dağılımlardan bir tanesi. Bunun şöyle bir özelliği var Fason sürecinin. Bunu da gene rastalda anlatmıştık, hatırlarsınız belki, şimdi örneğini de anlatayım. İki tane Fason sürecini birleştirirseniz şurada gene bir Fason süreci elde ediyorsunuz. Tamam, mesela burada neydi? Bir restoran vardı. Hep bu örneği veriyorduk. Restorana bayan müşteriler ve erkek müşteriler geliyor. Bayanların geliş rate'i lambda 1, erkek müşterilerin geliş rate'i lambda 2 idi. Toplam müşterilerin geliş rate'i ise gene Fason oluyordu. Rate'i ise bu rate'lerin toplamı oluyordu. Lambda 1 artı lambda 2. Yani iki Fason'u birleştirirsek gene Fason süreci elde ediyoruz. Rate'i de bu iki Fason rate'inin birleşiminden elde ediliyor. Bu da Fason'un bir özelliğiydi. Buradan da çok soru gelmişti size rastalda. Bizim önem verdiğimiz konulardan biriydi hatırlarsanız. Şunu yapalım ve geçen haftayı bitirmiş olalım. Evet, geçen haftayı bitirmiş olalım. Şimdi bir yere, iş yerine jobs'lar geliyor Fason süreciyle. Rate'i de lambda 3. Saatte 3 tane iş geliyormuş. Bu iş gelen işlerin 3'te 1'i yüksek öncelikli işmiş. 3'te 2'si ise düşük öncelikli işmiş. What is the probability that 2 saat içinde yüksek öncelikli iş gelmeme ihtimali nedir? Tamam mı? Yani bir yere işler geliyor, jobs. Jobs Fason sürecine geliyor, göre geliyor. Bu işlerin bir kısmı çok önemli, high priority, bir kısmı ise low priority. Low priority yani düşük öncelikli iş. İşlerin geliş rate'i, toplam geliş rate'i lambda 3. Yani saatte 3 tane iş geliyor. Anlaşıldı mı? Bunların bir kısmı high priority, bir kısmı low priority. Şimdi bize diyor ki 2 saat içinde hiç yüksek öncelikli iş gelmeme ihtimali. Evet, nasıl yapabiliriz sizce bunu? Fason sürecine göre işler geliyor. Bu işlerin, şimdi bakın, bu da split deniyor arkadaşlar. Buna split deniyor. Fason'u bölmek. Az öncesi combine etmekti. Az önce gördüğünüz şu combination'dı. İki Fason'u combine ediyoruz, gene Fason elde ediyoruz. Aynısı şeyde de doğru. Fason'u aldınız ve ikiye böldünüz. Şu elde ettiğiniz gene Fason oluyor. Yani buna da splitting a Fason deniyor. Şurada combine etmiştik. Şimdi bunun rate'i lambda ise, mesela lambda 3 ya bunun rate'i. Bunun rate'i lambda 3. Yüksek öncelikli olma ihtimali P1 diyelim. Buna da P2. Yüksek öncelikli olma ihtimali 1 bölü 3. Düşük öncelikli olma ihtimali ise 2 bölü 3. Değil mi? Yani şu koldan gitme ihtimali 1 bölü 3. Şu koldan gitme ihtimali gelen bir işin 2 bölü 3. O zaman yüksek öncelikli işlerin dağılımı da Fason olacak. Rate'i ne olacak? Rate'i. Bunun rate'i lambda çarpı P1. Bunun rate'i ise lambda çarpı P2. Evet arkadaşlar, yani P1 olasılık ve P2 olasılıkla çarpıyoruz. Dolayısıyla yüksek öncelikli işlerin dağılımı, şu soruya gidelim tekrar. Yüksek öncelikli işlerin dağılımı Fason oluyor. Ve rate'i de şurayı daha güzel yazalım. Evet, rate'i de lambda çarpı P1, yani lambda 3 olduğuna göre 3 çarpı 1 bölü 3'ten lambdası 1 oluyor. Evet. Anlaşıldı mı arkadaşlar, bu nasıl?
Evet hocam, anlaşıldı.
Tamam mı? Evet. Lambdası 1 olan bir Fason oluyor. Yani sadece artık şeyleri unutabilirsiniz. Düşük öncelikli işleri unutun, yokmuş gibi. Sadece yüksek öncelikli işler geliyor. Bağımsız onları, sadece onları düşünelim. Neymiş? Yüksek öncelikli işlerin dağılımı pas olmuş ve lambdası da 1'miş. Şimdi bize ne diyor? Probability that yüksek öncelikli iş gelmeme ihtimali. N1T'nin 0 olma ihtimali. Bunu nasıl bulacağız? Bir önceki formülü açarsak. Poisson formülünü şurada. Poisson process formülü. E üzeri eksi lambda T. Lambdamız ne? 1. T'miz ne? T'miz nedir arkadaşlar? Soruya tekrar bakalım. 2 saat içinde. 2 saat içinde yüksek öncelikli iş gelmemesi. Bu T'miz, değil mi? 2 saat bizim toplam süreç. Yani 2 saat boyunca bakıyoruz. Lambda 1 saatlik rate. 1 saatlik rate. T ise süreç, ne kadar sürede iş gelmeme ihtimaline bakıyoruz. Yani burada T'miz 2. Değil mi? Evet. Şimdi formüle gidelim tekrar. Gene lambda T üzeri N. Yani lambdamız 1, T'miz 2 üzeri N. N'imiz kaç? N kaç arkadaşlar? N yerine ne yazmamız lazım? Sıfır olması. Zero. Evet. Bölü sıfır faktöriyel. Yani cevap bu. Evet. Tamam, cevap bu arkadaşlar. Yani 0.135'miş. Tamam mı? Yani bizim amacımız şey değil. Hani bunları review olarak yaptığım için biraz hızlı gidiyorum arkadaşlar. Ve çok fazla konumuz var. O yüzden yani anlamıyorsanız biraz tekrar dinleyin ya da ekstra kaynaklara bakın. Bunlar they are supposed to be review yani. O yüzden evet. Tamam arkadaşlar, bunu geçiyorum şimdi. Şimdi bir de son bir tane daha var arkadaşlar. Empirical distribution var son konumuzda. Empirical distribution kolay bir konu. Ne yapıyoruz burada biliyor musunuz? Datanız var. Datanız var ama çok az. Mesela şöyle bir datanız var. 3, 5, 7, 11, 1, 20. Yani bir müşterilerin geliş süresine alakalı çok az bir datanız var ve buna hiçbir şey fit etmiyor. Yani buna üstel diyemiyoruz, normal diyemiyoruz. Hiçbirisini fit edemiyoruz. Yapabileceğiniz şey şu. Rastsal sayı üretip, yani bu verileri türetip duruyorsunuz. 1, 3, 5, 7, 11, 20'yi tekrar tekrar simülasyonunuzda türetiyorsunuz. Buna empirical distribution deniyor. Yani 3'ü, 5'i, 7'yi sizin alabileceği değerler oluyor ve hepsinde olasılığı aynı oluyor. Kaç sayı var burada? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tane data noktası var. 1 bölü 6 olasılıkla hepsini simülasyonunuzda türettirseniz bu empirical oluyor. Anlaşıldı mı? Evet. Bu da son yöntem. Evet. Empirical distribution'un tanımı. Sorunuz var mı arkadaşlar buraya kadar? Evet, o zaman yeni bir konuya geçebiliriz. Şimdi geçeceğim konu review değil. Yeni bir konu. O yüzden daha iyi, daha yavaş anlatabilirim. Fakat dediğim gibi bayağı bir konum şeyimiz var. Bugün cover etmemiz gereken yer var. Evet, İngilizceye geçeceğiz, yeni konuda demiştim. So our new topic is random number generation. Remember this class is in two parts, for A and for B. So in this first part, you are not supposed to learn how to generate uniform 0-1 random numbers. How Excel or any other computer program generates uniform random numbers. In 4B, you are going to learn how to transform uniform into other distributions like exponential, normal, discrete. All distributions that you learned are comes from this uniform 0-1. That is why it is important. Okay, everything is generated from a uniform 0-1 distribution. So this is our objective today. And in random number generation, we need an algorithm. An algorithm that will give us uniform 0-1 random numbers, okay? And we call it, when there is an algorithm, we call it pseudo random number, or it is called PRN. So what is PRN? Pseudo random number generator. Pseudo random number generator. So when I gave you a method, they are called PRN generators. Why is it called P? Pseudo means false. False. So it is actually not random. It is actually an algorithm. So pseudo random number generator means it is a it's an algorithm which seems to be random, but which is actually based on an algorithm. Okay. So we want to have random numbers R1, R2, R3. They look like random, and they come from uniform 0-1 distribution. This is our whole objective. But we want a good generator. It should be very good. Good means when you plot this, first of all, when you put your, so they should look like this. They should be between 0 and 1, your random numbers, and they should be uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. So I want uniformity, okay? And those numbers should be independent. Okay, they should be independent of each other, uniform. These are my very two important things I require from a good generator. If they are not have these properties, then they are problematic. Okay, a good generator must have these two properties. Number one, it should be uniform. Number two, independent. Okay, so you are going to give me random numbers, and I can tell you whether they are uniform. There are tests. I'm going to teach you how to test a generator. We will do two tests, uniformity test and independence test, okay? So do you understand the difference? Uniformity means, for instance, this is not uniform. I create a generator and my random numbers I generate are here, 0.5, 0.4, 0.6, 0 point, so numbers I generate always are here in the middle, concentrate in the middle, sometimes here, sometimes here, but mostly here. Is this uniform? Do you think this is uniform generator? No, right? This is a bad generator. So if you look at the density, it's like this. What you are generating looks like normal, more normal than uniform. So what I want is numbers distributed evenly over all between 0 and 1. This is uniformity, okay? And independence means all the numbers you generate should be independent of each other. I will show you when it is not independent. I will give you examples. So let's clear this and let's continue. So our plan. We are going to suggest some algorithms and see which one is better. What I want, something fast, something portable with different computers. I can use it on Windows or Mac, okay, Apple, on different programs. And it should have a long cycle, and you will understand what is cycle soon. What does cycle mean? Okay, these are the properties of a good random number generator. And here is an example. So most random number generators works like this. So I am not giving you the algorithm right now, but the idea is this. You start with a seed. So this is called seed, x0. From using x0, you generate next random number. Using x1, you generate the next one, and next one. So the basic idea is this. There is a function using xi, it gives you xi plus one, the next number, okay? And then these numbers doesn't have to be between 0 and 1. They don't have to be between 0 and 1. They might be bigger than one, okay? This is not always true, okay? So what you need to do is make them between 0 and 1. To do that, you divide the xi by the maximum value that x can take, so that what you get is between 0 and 1. So you will understand better with examples, I promise. So I will do examples and you will understand better. So sometimes there are very bad generators. So it bad generator is like this. It always generates the same number, which is a degenerate, very bad generator. So I will give you a historical generator, one of the very old ones. One of the old G functions that are used in history. It is called mid-square method. So this method, what do they do is, they take the middle four digits of xi square, middle four digits. Look, if you start with x0 equal to 9322, so this is your seed. What is x1? How do we calculate x1? So x1 is equal to, x1 is equal to
square of 32.
Yes, we need to square this number. Okay, we need to square this number. And so this is the x0 squared. So which gives you this number. And the middle four digits, the middle here. So I just, just let me. So the middle four digits of the x square is going to be your next number, x1. So x1 is, so middle digits of this. So x1 is 8996. How do you calculate x2? Take the square of this and then take the middle four digits. Okay, this is a historical method, not a very good one. There is also mixed product method, constant multiplier methods. These are not used anymore. Okay, so let's go to something more current. And this is the current one that's used in Excel or in most computer programs. It is, in short, is called LCM, linear congruential method, which is based on a modulus. Do you remember modulus from mathematics? Do you remember modulus M?
Yes.
Yes, it's not very difficult. So this is like this. This is your function, xi plus 1 in terms of the previous number, xi. How does it work? So this function is a number multiplier A, an increment C, and a modulus M. So what you do is multiply your previous number by A, add C, and take the modulus M. The choice of these are these four things, 1, 2, 3, 4 things determines the generator. So to use a congruential, to construct this generator, you need to give me four information. What is A, what is C, and what is starting seed? Okay. And then what you get, how do you convert xi into a random number? So in modulus M, what is the maximum number x can take? If you remember modulus M, what is the maximum value that x can take? If you are using modulus M, can it be bigger than M?
M minus one.
Yes, it cannot be bigger than M, right? The maximum value it will take, it will not take, but the upper limit for X is M. M is the maximum, okay? So random number, to make X into a 0, 1, what you do is just divide by M. XI divided by the modulus will give you a something between 0 and 1, for sure. So you return this random, this number R with this congruential generator. So let's continue. I will give you some examples. For instance, let's try this generator. So here the generator is defined. X0 is 20, starting seed 27, A value 17, C value 43, and modulus 100. So look at how X1 is calculated. Remember, A times XI plus C in modulus M. This is the formula for XI plus 1. So if XI is, to calculate X1, what I should do is multiply 27 by 17 at, so this is A, this is X0, this is C. Do you see it? So which is 502? In modulus 100, this is simply 2. You know modulus arithmetic, right? You divide by 100. What is the remainder is the answer. So X1 is 2. So this is not between 0 and 1. This is a bigger than 1. So to make it between 0 and 1, what you do is you divide the X1 by 100, which will give you your random number. So here you have your first random number. How do you find the next one? Now I need to use X1 here. To find X2, I need to use X1. And which will give me 77, which is 0.77. Similarly, to find X3, so do you understand the idea?
Yes.
Yeah, it's not very difficult, as you can see. This is a very simple idea and very efficient one. Okay. Now, but we need to choose these numbers carefully to get a good generator. We want a good. Look at this. Is this a good generator? This is the example that we have used. So we start with 27. Next number 2. Next number 77. Next number 52. And the next one is the next one is again, where is my pen? Here, so 52 and the next one is 27 again.
Hocam, bu A, C ve M sayılarını kafamıza göre mi seçiyoruz? Bir mantığı var mı?
Yes, there is a formula. They are design issues. They are designed. Okay, they are chosen by you. When you specify those numbers, they give you a generator, but it can be bad or good. I am asking, is this a good generator or bad one?
It's a bad one. It's not independence.
Yeah, why is it bad? Why do you think this is bad?
Başa dönmüş çünkü.
Evet, yes, hem very... başa dönmüş. Yes, hem de bir good. Öncekine bağımlı olarak gidiyor. Yani ben logaritmayı da sevmiş. Orada algoritma da güzel. Hmm.
Generators are like this. They are xi plus 1 is calculated from xi. But you are right that this is a very short cycle. So after this, the same thing will repeat. So you can only generate 1, 2, 3, 4 values. That's it. This generator can only generate 4 numbers. Very bad one indeed. So this is a very bad generator, okay? This is not a good one. We say this is called a cycle. Remember, I will told you what a cycle means. This is a cycle. So this is a very short cycle. Because look at this. When you put 27, you will get 2 again. And history repeats, right? Same things will happen as before. So you will only observe these 4 numbers over and over and over, which is a bad, very bad one. So this is called the cycle length. And we want this to be large as possible. But when you change something, very small change, what did we change? I just changed X0. Just change, I keep ACM same. I just changed X0 to 13 and look at the cycle length. Now much bigger, right? So again, it has a cycle. Every generator has a cycle, everyone. But what we want is a big cycle. So that we don't know. So what happens is that you start with 13, okay? Then you generate 64, then you generate 31. It goes on like this and then comes back to 13. So you see the idea of what is a cycle mean? But in Excel, cycles are so big that even in the largest simulation, largest model that you will use, you will not use even this much of the cycle. Okay, so you will not see the cycle at all. So this cycle length in Excel or other real generators are so big, this cycle, that you only need maybe this much of the generator, even less. Do you understand? Okay. So these are called cycles. So we want to have a good cycle and maximum period. This is also, the cycle is also called period. Okay, and so there is a theorem. I will tell you quickly. Okay, we are not even done with the first slides. So this theorem says that, look at the generator. Do you see this generator? It is a LCG generator, linear congruential. This generator can have the cycle length of maximum 2 üzeri b minus 2. This theorem is proved, by the way. It is proved. The maximum cycle length can be this much. Look at the modulus, 2 to the b. And you can achieve this cycle length when x0 is odd. What is odd? What does odd mean?
Tek sayı mıydı hocam?
Yes, odd means 3, 5, 6, 3, 5, 7, right? Odd number. And a is equal to 8k plus minus 3. Okay, so a is in the form of this. So k can take any number. K is an integer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If these are achieved, that it is proved that the cycle length will be 2 zero by b minus 2. For instance, what is the period for this generator? What is the period? Now, you can do this either by trial error using Excel and see for yourself. Generate every number and see where is the cycle starts. Or you can use this theorem. I can write 64 as 2 to the power 6, right? So my b is 6. So b is equal to 6. And a is equal to 13. Is it odd or not? Can I use this theorem? A is odd. So 13, is this an odd number or not?
Odd.
Yeah, this is an odd number, right? This is not even. So yes, a is odd. So 13, is 13 in this format? So can I write 13 as like this?
Yes.
For if I use k equal to 2 and minus, it seems I can write this a in this format. So theorem applies. This theorem is valid for this generator. It means that this generator will have the maximum cycle length, which is 2 to the b minus 2. 2 to the 4. The cycle length for this generator will be 2 to the power 4. Okay, so in the past, I used to give you the Excel generator, but I think I removed it. So Excel generator also uses this, this method that I just showed you. And the modulus is a big, very big number. It's huge. The modulus M they use in Excel is a very big number. And their idea is the same as here. Now, in the remaining 4 minutes, there are 4 minutes, the rest of the class, okay, we have a lot of things to cover. Okay, I want to teach you two tests, okay? So remember, you gave me a generator and with a good cycle length. Let's say cycle length is good, generator looks very good, but I want evidence. I want mathematical tests that it is really good. So I am going to conduct two tests, number one, number two. So how do I do this? You give me the method, your algorithm, and I generate random numbers, R1, R2, R3, R4, which are from your generator that you say is very good. And using those random numbers from your generator, I will first test for uniformity. Are they uniform or not? Your numbers, are they really uniform? And then I am going to test for independence. Are the numbers are really independent or there are problems with your generator? Do you understand? Remember, a good generator should be uniform and independent random numbers have these properties. So I will test for these two properties. And in the uniformity, the hypothesis is this. Random numbers you generate are really uniform. And alternative, no, they are not. So I will do this test. I will show you how to do this test. Second case, it says that random numbers you generate are independent. They are very nice and independent. The alternative says, no, they are not. Okay. So this is what we are going to do for second part of the class. I will teach you how to test given random data for uniformity and independence. First, in the remaining 2 minutes, so we are using every minute to the point. Do you remember alpha and beta from the hypothesis testing? Let's remember hypothesis testing. What was alpha and beta in hypothesis testing? Anybody remember? You are going to conduct tests, hypothesis tests, but to conduct a statistical test, if you remember from your statistics class, you need to give me alpha. Usually it is 5%. If you took quality control from me this summer, previous summer, you know that we use these alpha and beta extensively in this class. We used alpha and beta a lot. But you also saw alpha and beta in statistics class. What was the definition of alpha? Which is level of significance. So if you remember in statistics class, someone should give you alpha before you start a test. Okay? Alpha is a level of confidence. Probability that this probability, you make a mistake. You reject H0, given H0 is true. This is called alpha. And to do any statistical test, this should be given to you. Okay, your confidence level. And beta is the other part of the test. It is defined as when hypothesis is false, probability that you will accept it. These are mistakes, right? These properties are bad things. Look, this is condition. Given H0 is true, you say you reject it. You just say it is not true. You make a mistake. So alpha and beta are mistakes, making bad decisions. Okay? So it is the probabilities of making bad decisions. Anybody who forgot these things or alpha, who say, do you say you remember those things or you forgot alpha and beta? Do you have any comments? Anybody? Okay. Okay then. We will come back to this alpha and beta later on. But I think you remember that you used alpha in hypothesis testing in statistics, right? You should have used these definitions. Let's give a break now, 8 minutes break, and I will see you in 3:30. And I will show you how to test for uniformity when I come back. Do you have any questions until now? Up to this point, do you have any questions? Okay, then I am stopping the recording. And so we are going to continue from testing for uniformity. Remember, we said we are going to test for uniformity and also independence. Now this test makes a lot of sense. I like this test very much because look, what we are going to do is for uniformity. So this is 0 and this is 1, right? And we are going to divide this into intervals in the chi-square test. So this is called, by the way, chi-square test. Chi-square test, because it is based on this. Do you remember the chi-square distribution? It's called chi-square distribution. So we are going to do this. We are going to divide this 0, 1 into equal length intervals. Assume that these are equal length intervals. So here, how much intervals do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 intervals. So in this chi-square test, I am using 5 intervals. I divided the 0 1 into 5 equal length intervals. So what you do is this. Let's say you generate 10 numbers. So you, as an example, you generate 10 random numbers. And if it is uniform, what do you expect? These 10 random numbers should be equal. In each basket, you should expect to see 2 numbers, right? In each of these intervals, there are 10, right? Divided by 5. Each should contain average of 2 random numbers. If it is really uniform. So what you should do is this. First of all, let's say these are the random numbers you generate. You generate 1 from here. Second random number you generated was here. Third here. And there is none here, 0. Fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth. So you see, these are called, so 3 random numbers here. So it's like, if you divide 0, 1 into 5, what is this number here? Let me just erase this. So 0 to 1 divided into 5 equal lengths. So 1 over 5 is equal to 0.2. Which means that this number is 0.2, this number is 0.4, this number 0.6, 0.8, and 1. So the length of each interval is 0.2, right? So the first, so your random number, the first one was, let's say, 0.18. So that's why it is in the first interval. First interval, second, third, fourth and fifth. So there are 5 intervals. So you look at 2 numbers for each interval. They are called observed and expected. So for instance, observed in interval number 1 is what? You observe how many random numbers? 3 in the first interval. But how much did you expect to see? What is the expected numbers? What? Huh? 2, right? There were 10 random numbers, total 10. And you said, if they are really uniform, I want to see, I would expect to see 2 numbers in each bin. So expected is 2 for the first bin. Actually, expected number in each bin is 2. Expected random numbers in each bin is 2. You expect to see 2. So observed in the first bin is 3. What is observed in the second bin?
0.
0. Observed in the third bin? I think we put 3 or 2. I think we put 2. Okay, 2. And then observed in the fourth bin is 3. And last one. 2. So do you understand what is observed? How many numbers do you observe in each bin? So you calculate as statistics. Look at how it is calculated. It is the difference between observed minus expected. Divided, taken square, divided by expected. And you sum over all the bins. So if this number is large, what do you say? If this number is very big, what is your conclusion? Is this uniform or not? Look at how it is calculated. It is the difference between observed minus expected. If it is really uniform, this number should be small, right? Because observed will be close to expected if they are really uniform. But if they are not close to each other, there is a big difference. These statistics that you calculate will be large, which means that they are not uniform. Do you understand the idea between chi-square test?
Yes. Can I ask you something?
Yes.
What was the 0.18?
0.18 is a random number, first random number. Your So you have, you said you generated 10, right? R1, R2, R3. Your data is like this, 10 random numbers, right? So 0.18 I gave as an example, your first random number, which is this one. To show you that it is in the first bin. Second random number, third. So look at their value and see where they fall. If the random number is less than 0.2, it means it belongs to first bin. If it is bigger than 0.8, it belongs to last bin.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so, but the next question, who says this is large or small, according to what? When do we say this is big? When do we say this is small? In this case, you need to do hypothesis testing, okay? So what you calculate here is called test statistics. In each hypothesis testing, this is the idea. You need two things, a test statistic and a number from the table, okay? So something you calculate from the data and something from the table, which table? It can be Z table, chi-square table, based on which test you are conducting. And you check if it is smaller than this or larger than this. And you arrive at a conclusion. So in this case, I need to, my critical, this is called critical value. Critical value from table. This is called test statistics from the data. This is calculated from data. This comes from the table. This is the general idea between every hypothesis testing. One number from the table, one number from the data, you compare them. This is why it is called critical value. Critical value is 1 minus alpha and some degrees of freedom. Okay. So look at this. And if the your test statistic chi-square, which you calculate from data, is bigger than the critical value from table, it means it is a very big one. You reject, means that they are not uniform. If it is smaller, you accept, means that data is uniform. This is the basic idea. Okay. And here is an example. Okay. Here is an example, which with 100 random numbers, 100 random numbers. And we are going to conduct chi-square test. Our random of our number of intervals is 10. They divided 0, 1 into 10 equal intervals, 10. I don't know if I made 10, I am not sure. So they divided this into 10 equal intervals. And for each interval, what you need is observed and expected. Can you tell me expected for each interval? This is your data. Okay. What is the expected number of random numbers in each interval? If you divide 0, 1.
1.
Into, huh?
1 değil mi hocam?
So there are 10 intervals. So there are 10 intervals, 100 numbers, right? If they are uniformly distributed, you expect?
10.
10, right? Each interval should have 10. Look, because 10 times 10 is 100, or 100 divided by 10 is 10. So there are 100 numbers, right? If I distribute them uniformly into 10 buckets, each bucket should contain 10 numbers. If you are uniform, if you are uniformly distributing them. So this is the first one, expected number. So here gives you the expected, which is 10 for each interval. And then what is the observed in the first interval? How do you find this? How do you find observed in the first interval? What you, so yeah, just tell me what to do.
We will find the number of randoms between 0 and 0.1.
Yes, very good. So the first one, look, the lower end is 0. The upper end is 0.1. So from this data, I need to look at number of, so for instance, which ones are in this interval? So so which ones are less than 0.1? Do you see any? 0.02 is less than 0.1.
0.05.
Where is it? Here, another one. You can mark it if you find it. Mark it. You can also edit this PDF. Everyone has a pen. You can edit it if you want. Anything? Yes, thank you. There is 0.05. Anything else? Any more? Oh, there is another one. Okay, 0.03. 4. Any more? There is another one. 5. Anything else? One more. Thank you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Anyway, is it it? That's it.
Hocam bir tane de 0.10 var ama hangi tarafa sayacağız onu?
Yes, let's keep the it is on the left. So as long as you are consistent, so the borders belongs to the left. Okay. So yes, there is one more. Thank you, İrem. And there is one more. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the observed is 8 in for the first interval, which you can also see here, 8. Second interval, 8. So what you see here is chi-square statistics calculated using Excel. And then when you calculate it, what you get is 3.4. Okay. So also you need the chi-square from the table. But which chi-square? In the table, you need two values to use chi-square table. What is alpha and what is critical value? Okay. So so for chi-square, you need to use as alpha. Alpha should be given to you. You'll need to use 5%. And critical value will always be n minus 1, which is number of intervals, which is 10 minus 1, 9. Okay, so this what number you need. By the way, reading the chi-square table is very easy compared to Z table. You just need alpha and the critical value, and it's automatically there. Chi-square table, reading it very easy. So do you accept or reject in this test? Do you accept or reject? So this is your test statistics. And this is from table, 3.4, 16.9 from table. This is from your data. So, yes, so we don't reject. So since what you calculate is less than critical value, it means data, we can say that count is uniform. Yes, it we can say it's uniform. Because remember, 8.0 says data is uniform. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, we have a lot of topics. Okay, the second test is for independence. Testing for independence, the second part. The first one was for uniformity, now for independence. Now the claim is that the numbers are independent, alternative is that they are not. There are many ways. I'm going to show you two of them. Run test, autocorrelation test, okay? As in any test, first of all, alpha should be given. In this simulation class, unless otherwise stated, we usually use this alpha value. In most of our examples, we use alpha 5% most of the time. So I want to show you an example of what is a not independent. What is independent? An example. Look at these coin throws. Head, head, head, head, tail, tail, tail, tail. Do you think this is independent? Do you think there is something wrong in this sample path? Yes, there is positive correlation, right? When there is head, the next one is most likely to be head instead of tail. So this means there is no independent. There is something wrong. There is a correlation. Once you observe tail, you see a series of tail and a series of another head. Okay? Do you understand? So this isn't positive. So what about this one? Now this is the opposite case. When it is a head, the next one is most likely to be tail. Head, tail, head, tail, head, tail. This is also something wrong here, something wrong. Okay, this is a negative correlation, positive. And this one seems fine. Okay, there is no runs. So run is called a run, a succession of similar events followed by a different event. We will reject H0 if there are too many runs. Too many runs, okay? Okay, run test assumes that numbers are already critical. Numbers pass the previous test. To do the independence test, you need to first make sure they pass the previous uniformity tests, okay? So here is an example. And the example says, do you think this sequence is independent or not? Is there any run problem or not? Do you think there is any problem?
Hocam bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Yes.
Ben bu iki testi mesela yalnızca uniform dağılan bir dataya mı uygulayabilirim?
Yes, so no, the run test, this one. So there are different independence tests, right? Here, run, autocorrelation test. So this one, just run test assumes that the numbers are uniform, that they come from a uniform distribution. But what we are testing is not uniformity. We are testing for independence, something else. We assume you already passed this point, uniformity. Now we are testing for something else, which is independence. So do you understand the meaning of run? It is a series of similar events. So look at this. This is my sample data. And I am asking if this data is looks normal or not. Okay, so it is theoretically proven that, so we need to use this information to do the run test. First of all, let's look at how many runs are there. Okay, how many runs in this sequence? So it is going up, right? So look at the first number, look at the second number. Is it increasing or decreasing? From 0.4 to 0.68.
Increasing.
So we have increasing. Here, what happens? Is it increasing or decreasing?
Decrease.
Here?
Decrease.
Increase, right? Decrease. Increase. And then what about here? Again, decrease, right? Here, decrease. And here, another decrease. So here we have a head, tail, head. So if you say increase is a pattern, increasing or decreasing is a pattern. So it means we have seen this pattern. Head, tail, tail. Okay. So what's the number of runs in this example? How many runs we have?
10.
So how many total number of points we have?
11 tane var, 10 tane çevirme var.
So we have 11 data points, right? So first of all, how many runs can I have, maximum possible number of runs?
N minus one.
Yes, it can be no bigger than N minus one, right? So So how do you find runs in this example? How do you find it? Do you have an idea? Okay, so n is 11, total number of data points. And then, so look, I'm going to call number of runs by a, right? So maximum it can take is this. And someone proved statistically that number of runs should be in an independent, if the data is independent, if there is no pattern, number of runs should be normally distributed with this mean and with this variance. They proved it. Okay, somebody proved this. And you look at this, okay, you look at normal distribution and it will be your test. If random of runs, if A is very big, then you reject that there is a problem. You reject, you say that there is a problem in the data. If the number of runs are less, then you accept. So number of runs should be normally distributed with this mean and with this variance. Do you understand this part? So this is from, this is given to you. This information is given for any data, independent of this example. So for any data, if the data is really independent, perfect, number of runs should follow. This is proven, okay, statistically proven. Follow this normal distribution. And in this case, you can count to change the switches. You can count, for instance, number of times it's going down. So you can either count to run downs or run ups. Okay, in a uniform case, it should be almost equal. So I'm going to count number of times it is down. Okay, the pattern of run downs. How many run downs do I have? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I have 6 tails, right? And 6 tails and remaining are heads. The remaining ones are heads. So my pattern, I'm going to say it is 6. A is equal to 6. N is 11. So I was expecting to see expected value of A, 2N minus 1 divided by 3, which is 7. Variance is 1.63, calculated using this formula by putting N equals to 11. And again, we are going to do, what we are going to do is a hypothesis testing. In this case, alpha is 0.05. From the table, Z value is given by 1.96. What is the statistical Z? Remember, in every hypothesis testing, you calculate one critical value from, you get one critical value from the table, one value from the data, Z zero. And I need to compare Z with Z alpha. Is it small or large? Okay, is it small or large? So I got this one. For alpha equal to 0.05, this is 1.96. You will memorize this number in this class. Since I told you we use 5% all the time, the critical value, Z value is 1.96. You will use it so much that you will memorize this number. What about this one? Z zero from the data. Do you remember how to make a normal, a standard normal? How do you make a normal variable, a standard normal? We subtract the mean, divide by sigma, correct? Is this correct? If you subtract the mean, divide by sigma, what you get was standard normal, which we will do the same here. Our A was 6 here. Okay, our A was equal to 6. And I'm going to standardize this. I'm going to make this standard. What will I do? Subtract from this the mean and divide by sigma. So your Z zero will be, so every, we, I used almost, Z zero will be, is it readable? Okay, not much. Okay. So I will clear this. It's too much things. Now let me clear. There are a lot of things on the board. Okay. So Z alpha, we got Z alpha. Z zero is going to be A minus the mean divided by sigma. So Z zero is going to be A is 6 minus mean is 7 divided by square root of this, which will give you minus 0.78. So do we accept or reject the test now? So you look at this, you compare Z zero with Z alpha, but the absolute value. So which is 0.78, this is 1.96, which is smaller than this, which means that we can accept that they are independent because there is not a lot of runs. You don't see a lot of runs. That's why we accept the test. Okay, so I need to clear this. Do you have any question?
Hocam bir şey sorabilir miyim? Hı hı. Şu ben kaçırdım sanırım. Hani n sayısı 20'den fazla olduğunda neye göre belirliyorduk? Hani 16 n 29 90 demişiz ya, o kısmı kaçırdım ben. Hani bu sayıları neye göre verdik?
Okay. Good question. I forgot to say that actually. Very good question. I said that this is proven in the statistical books, right? Normally, this is true if your number of data points is more than 20. What is true is that number of runs is normally distributed with this mean and with this variance. Okay? This is what I said. In our example, n is 11. It is just to show you as an example. So normally for this theorem to be true, we need at least 20 observations. But in this case, to show you the idea, we are doing this theory on a data with 11 data points. So do you understand?
Evet hocam.
So you put 11, we put here 11 to find the mean and 11 to find the variance. Okay, here. So do you remember how to use the Z table? So here our Z, so this is our 1.96 minus 1.96. And remember our test statistic was here, minus 0.78 in the previous example. So if it is in this range, your test statistics, we accept. If it is outside this range, we reject. So this is your Z zero, this is your Z critical values. These are Z alpha values. These are the critical. And if your Z value, calculated value is in this range, we accept. Outside this range, we reject. So one last example is this one. Okay, this is our last example for today. Autocorrelation test. So what you have seen is called Runz test. Runz test. There is also something called autocorrelation test. So do you know the meaning of autocorrelation? What does it mean? So you know the meaning of correlation, related. You know the meaning of auto. So what do they mean, autocorrelation? So in this case, we test for this, okay? So are there any pattern? We test for specific patterns on the random numbers. What do I mean? So we are going to use this idea, row I, M. Starting with the ith value, ith number, in this example, we will use I equal to 3. Are those every, so M is going to be equal to 5. I will look at every fifth number. So look, one, starting from this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Next fifth number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So are there any correlation between those numbers? So are they always increasing? Is there any pattern that you can find between those numbers? Is called autocorrelation. Why is it auto? Because it is between the numbers, its own numbers. And correlation means, are they related to each other? Okay, so there are many things you can test. You can start with this and test for every fifth number. Then it will be I is equal to one, starting with the first one. But as an example, I want to show you the case where I start with the third number and check for every fifth number, are they correlated or not? Okay, so these are the numbers that I am going to use. It is a well-defined test. So again, as usual, you need something from the data, compare it with the critical value. If it is less, accept. If it is bigger, reject. Same idea, nothing changes. But there is a formula here, and I give you these formulas in the exams if you need it. Formulas will be given to you. You don't need to memorize anything. You just need to memorize the basic idea. So in the autocorrelation test, remember, you have something from the data, Z0. How do you calculate this from the data? Using this formula. Okay, so it looks complicated, but it is not actually. It is not very big deal. It just uses random numbers. You multiply each random number, sum them together, and subtract the 25. This is how you get this denominator. For the denominator, you need to use this. And in the end, what you will get is a test statistic Z0. Okay. Do you understand this? Is it clear? Okay, yeah, you have seen a lot of things today, I know. Okay, so let's do an example. What is capital M here? What is capital M? So this is better to show you on an example. Okay, I will show you on this example. Let's continue with this example. So here in this example, as I told you, I want to test whether these numbers in green are correlated. They are related to each other. For this, I need to use this row I M. I need to use this row I M. So I is equal to 3. Okay, because I am starting with the third number. What about the M? So to calculate M, you need to use this formula. Where is this formula? We didn't put it here. Here, you need to use this formula. Okay, so let me write it here. I plus M plus 1 times M less than equal 10. So capital, so small M, you understand the small M, right? This is the cycle length. I is the starting value. M is the maximum number which satisfies this equation. Maximum number which satisfies this equation, capital M. Okay, so basically it is this one. So capital M is how many cycles you have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I have 5 cycles. Okay. So first of all, let me ask you this question. Do you understand what we are doing here? Do you understand the basic idea? Anybody can tell me what we are doing?
Ben bir şey anlayamadım. Şimdi cycle neden 5 çıktı?
Okay.
Bir orayı tekrar alırsanız sevinirim. Hani ne mantığıyla yaptık orayı?
Okay. So okay, so let's clear. Let's clear some of the things. Okay, I cannot. Okay. First of all, let's start from the beginning. So I want to test for autocorrelation. I want to test whether those numbers are correlated, right? So the pattern is this. So I want to find this correlation, rho im. If it is close to one, there it means so correlation is always between minus one and one. If it is close to one, it means they are positively correlated. If it is close to zero, no correlation. Close to minus one, negative correlated. So I want to find this autocorrelation number, okay? This is the first thing. Now, which numbers am I looking at? The I is equal to three. I am starting with the third number and every fifth number. This is given by the problem. Problem says start with the third number and look at every fifth observation and see if there is a pattern. This is given in the question to me. Now in the formula, there is something like this. To be able to use this formula, what I need, if you look at the formula, you need something called capital M. You see it everywhere, capital M, right? So I need to find what is capital M. How do you find this? So you already know I and M is already given to you. You need capital M. And how do you find capital M? You need to use this. Okay, this is related to number of cycles minus one. So in my example, what is I? Three, right? In my example, plus, I don't know M, plus one times M should be less than equal to, what was number of data points in the example?
30.
So which M makes this true? Which value of maximum M makes this true, this equation? Four. So M is four, okay? Do you understand how M is going? Now, once you find the M, you have the M, you have the I, you have the small M, you have everything. Now you can use this formula. Once you have the capital M. Is it clear now?
Evet hocam.
Now it is better, right? Okay. So let's clear the table. So this formula doesn't seem to make sense, but what they are doing is actually how many number of cycles you have in your data. How many patterns are, but minus one. Look, how many M's you have in your data. Do you understand? Look at this, look at my data. I will erase this. So look how many cycles I, starting with this one, I am looking at the next one. First, my first jump. From here, I go to this one, second jump. Third jump, fourth, and fifth. There are five cycles minus one gives you the capital M. Or you can use this formula they give you. You can use the formula they gave you. Okay, so I'm going to erase this. Now I can use the formula that was given to me to find rho 3, 5. Remember the formula said 1/n+1. So then summation, the summation says this, what we have in the summation, look at the formula, all the numbers multiplied together. So what does it mean? This times this plus this times this plus this times this plus this times this. Do you understand? This is the formula they have for the rho, and the sigma is easily calculated using the capital M, and then your this is your rho, this is your sigma. And do you think they are correlated or not? Do you think they are correlated or not? Now, rho is close to zero. Correlation factor is negative, but close to zero. So I am not sure. Is it big enough or small enough? At 5% confidence, I am not sure. It's very close to zero. It is not close to minus one. They seem to be not correlated, but I need to test it to be sure. So for this, again, you need two numbers. From the data, calculated value, and from the table, critical value, and compare. Okay, so this is your calculated value from the data. How do we get this? This number divided by this number. So this is my Z number, -1.516. Do you remember the Z value for the 5% confidence? What was Z? 1.96. Is it smaller? The absolute value. Is it smaller than 196? Yes, right? It's smaller, which means it is small enough. Yes, we can assume that data is not autocorrelated, that they are independent. Is it clear what we have done? So that's it. We have tested for autocorrelation and they seem to be independent and there is no autocorrelation observed, at least for this. Starting with the third number, every fifth number doesn't seem to be correlated. You can also check this. Row 1, 4, starting with the first number, every fourth number. There are many, many things you can check. Starting with the second number, every third number. So there are many possibilities. This is the basic idea, okay? In the uniform 0-1 generation, I think I will not start the next topic, which is, because we have only 3 minutes left, which is incredible. We almost used all of this time for the first slide. So we don't have enough time to start this random variety generation. So I'm going to talk about this probably next week or next class Friday. I will think about this. So this is a small one, by the way. This doesn't take as much as the other one. This is just 13 slides. Once you understand the idea of uniform 0-1 generation, this will be much simpler. It will not take much as long as this class, the first one. But this is for a later time, it seems. I have to do it in a later time. Do you have any question for the first part of this class, which is random number generation? Uniform 0-1.
Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim? Bu son slide'daki küçük n toplamda kaç sıçrama yaptığı değil de kaçta bir sıçrama yaptığı, değil mi? Hani 0.23'den 0.28'e 5 veriden sonra ulaştığı yani.
Hangi soru için demiştin?
Bu son soru. Son slide. Son slide dedi.
Son slide. Şu mu?
Yok. Bu 0.12'si bir önceki mi oluyor acaba? 30 verinin ya. Evet, burası. Ha. Küçük n'i bulurken 0.23'den 0.28'e 5 sonra geldiği için küçük n 5'ti. Onu sordum.
Ha, burada küçük n yok ki bizim formülde.
Küçük m hocam. Manisa'nın
mesela. Ha, küçük m. Tamam. Evet, evet. Aynen. Küçük m cycle gibi düşünebilirsin. E starting number. Starting with the third number. M de kaçıncıya bakıyorsun? Bak, E indeksi bu. Üçüncü number. Buradan sayıyorum bak. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Her 5 rakamda bir. Sonra buradan sonra bak. 5 tane gideceğim. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.'si bu oluyor gene. Yani her 5'te bir oluyor. Üçüncüden başlayıp her 5'te bir. Bunu yalnız tabii her kombinasyonu düşünmektense, her EM kombinasyonu için bu testi yapmaktansa, mantıklı olan şüphelendiğiniz birisi varsa, değil mi? Mesela şurada bir şüphelendiğiniz pattern var. Onu test etmek daha mantıklı olur. Evet. Evet, başka sorunuz var mı arkadaşlar? Evet, bu arkadaşlar, bu independence testi idi. Bir de uniformity, ki kare testi bu diyoruz buna Türkçesinde, Türkçe istatistik kitaplarında ki kare. İngilizcesi chi square dedik. Bu chi square'ı kullanarak kullanılıyor. Bu arkadaşlar çok genel bir test. Yani biz hani uniform 01 için test ettik ya. Bir data var elinizde ve bu data uniform 01'e fit ediyor mu, etmiyor mu? Bunun testini yaptık değil mi? Yani uniformdan geliyor mu, gelmiyor mu? Evet ya da hayır dedik. İleriki chapter'larda göreceksiniz. Bu ki kare testi tekrar karşınıza gelecek. Bu ki kare çok genel bir test. Elinizde bir data var ve bu datayı uniform mu değil mi diye test edebilirsiniz ya da claim'iniz şudur. Diyorsunuzdur ki benim datam, bu gördüğün datayı, ben şunu sileyim. Silemeyeyim. Şöyle ha. Bu gördüğünüz data, ben bunu exponential ürettim. Lambdası da 5 olan bir exponential ürettim. Birisi diyor ki al bu datayı, ben exponential 5 için ürettim. Bunun için de test yapabilirsiniz. Yani ki kare testi çok genel bir test. Sadece uniformity 0-1 için değil. Verilen bir datayı herhangi bir dağılıma uygun mu değil mi testini yapabiliyoruz. Şu anda en basitini yaptık ki karenin. Uniform 0-1'e fit eder mi etmez mi testini yaptık. Ama ileride birisi de diyecek ki ben bir data ürettim ve bu data exponential lambda 5'ten geliyor diyecek. Biz de aynı idea'yı, aynı fikri kullanacağız. Bu observed, expected, böyle expected aynı fikir, aynı formül. Sadece bir ufak farklar olacak. Göreceksiniz. Exponential için yapacağız aynısını. Burada gördüğünüzün tekrar karşımıza çıkacak yani.
Hocam exponential için yaptığımızda observed unity falan hesaplarken farklı bir şeyler evet. Hesaplayacağız değil mi orada?
Evet evet, orada bir şeyler değişecek yani. Uniform o yüzden biraz daha basit dedim. Uniform'da bu en basiti şu oluyor basitleştiren. Şimdi uniform'da siz bunu eşit aralıklara bölüyorsunuz ya. Bu çok kolaylaştırıyor işi. Exponential'da işler şöyle karışacak. Eşit aralık ne demek? Biraz o karışacak. Çünkü eşit aralıklara bölseniz eşit olmuyor. Şurası çok alan, buranın büyük, buranın alanı daha küçük. Eşit alanlara bölmeniz gerekiyor. Uniform'da uzunluklar eşit olsa yetiyor. Ama siz exponential'da ben eşit uzunlukta bölsem olmuyor. Çünkü bakın şuraya azıcık bir kere sonsuza gidiyor bu. Kaç tane aralık olacak? Yani kafanızı şimdi onunla karıştırmayın. Fakat ileride tekrar karşınıza gelecek. Onları anlatacağım. Ama ki kare testini bir daha göreceğiz yani. Bir daha karşımıza çıkacak.
Hocam peki bu testing for independence'ı da herhangi bir dağılıma göre yapabiliriz değil mi? Bir şey fark etmeyecek.
Evet. Test for independence dağılım değil de size herhangi bir verilen sayı serisi için yapabilirsiniz. Yani buradaki serilerin özelliği 0-1 arasında olmasıydı. Fakat size böyle herhangi bir sayı serisi verildiğinde ve bir dediğinde bu seriler independent dediğinde bu testi uygulayabilirsiniz. Hatta sayı bile olmasına gerek yok. Run testini şöyle bir pattern'e de uygulayabilirsiniz. Burada kaç tane run var? Ondan sonra bu run'lar gerçekten independent değil mi diye sembollere bile yapabilirsiniz run testini.
Tamam hocam, anladım. Teşekkür ederim.
Evet. Evet arkadaşlar, bugünlük bu kadar. Yani sorunuz yoksa bugünlük bu kadar. Ve ödev sorunuz ya da başka bir sorunuz varsa sorabilirsiniz tabii. Tamam. O zaman cuma günü görüşmek üzere. Cuma günü görüşmek üzere. Hoşça kalın arkadaşlar. İyi günler.
İyi günler hocam. Evet.